from conservation biologists all over the world that really conveyed to many people in politics and in the political debates on environment around the world the importance of something that we missed, the areas without roads. You can start the first presentation, please. So, the global roadless areas that we are going to see after my short presentation. We have NGOs like Amazonia here in Brazil and all over the world that are fighting exactly for the protection of roadless areas in each and every part of our beautiful planet. Okay. So I'd like to share with you some thoughts that come from 1855. It's Chief Seattle. It's a phrase that I guess you already read when you were a child or later on. Humankind has not woven the web of life. We are but one thread within it. Whatever we do to the web, we do to ourselves. All things are bound together. All things connect. For me, this phrase is essential because in one phrase, we have the three reasons why we should protect roadless areas. We have the environment protecting the web that sustains life. We have the indigenous people that live in these roadless areas very often, and very often they don't want roadless areas to change. They don't want their way of living to change. And of course, we do have the economic benefits that derive from protection of roadless areas and the protection of ecosystem services they provide, which are beyond only the sequestration of carbon, but the management of the water cycle, the prevention for floods, the protection from spreading of disease, and many, many others. So what is a roadless area? Roadless area is an area that has not roads, but it doesn't mean that it does not, the points within it are not connected by other ways. Roadless areas may have trains, roadless areas may have ports and riverways. Roadless areas may even have airports, small airports, local airports. What is the difference between trains, the railways, and the ports, and even these very small airports, is that once you have a road, once, let's say, we have a road, anyone can take with illegal manners, a bulldozer and open another one, or it can be the initial service to expand this network, and thus then what I call the spider net of roads expands, and man-made pressure towards these areas expands. If we were to protect an area that has a road, it's much more complicated. The institutional framework, in order that this protection is established, it would be much more costly to put all the manpower which is necessary to guard this institutional framework of protection. So if we want to protect an area, if we have identified that for environmental reasons this an area should be protected, or that for because exactly that of the local population the right to manage their land, we should not go and make a project there. Keeping an area roadless secures both the human rights and the environment and the ecosystem services and the economic benefits that derive from that. So here we can see the Amazon, and we can see how this spider net of roads expands into the forest. This increases illegal logging enforcement, threatening the individual property rights, and that often leads to tribal extinction. I'm sure you've heard the stories of people in the Peruvian Amazon, tribes that have been found accidentally when miners moved into the forest, opening roads and moving into the forest for mining concessions, and then getting in touch with tribal people that get them affected by the disease that did not encounter. Very similar story than what had happened back in the 1500s, and thus this tribe being extinct. We know the story of the Serengeti National Park, Tanzania. There again, there was a big fight in order that a road should not cross the Serengeti National Park, this very well established and internationally known national park. The arguments that were heard and the road was stopped was that this road will lead to habitat fragmentation, soil erosion, will help the spreading of animal diseases and loss of endangered species, will disrupt the animal movement and migration, that will lead to invasive species being spread and environmental contamination take place. Economic reasons like the decline in tourism, such a well-known wildlife tourist destination. And of course, what is very important for environment in Africa, a high probability of illegal poaching and logging. Again, a recent story from Bolivia. You all know the Timbiza Reserve and how there was a big demonstration against the road being built in Bolivia. Three tribes live within this reserve. They want to stay roadless. They don't want this big infrastructure to cross their own habitat and the natural habitat. And it was these reasons that they conveyed to the government that stopped this road. Here you can see in the Amazon, areas of risk for deforestation, and I'm sure that Mr. Mariano will present similar pictures. And here you can see the roads that have been expanded. If you see, it's where the roads are that is the risk for deforestation. So we talk about the social benefits that include respecting the decisions of indigenous people living in these areas. If the indigenous people want a road, nobody can say no. But if they don't, we should be respecting their own rights. Social benefits will include, of course, what the ecosystem services provide, how these roadless areas provide also for a barrier for the spread of human diseases, and so on. The environmental benefits, I don't believe us to stay much on this topic. It's very clear, the protection of the ecosystem services, what exactly was said before, that consists the web that on which we depend, our lives depend. Some very recently, we had a very big success internationally. In Nagoya, we managed to have an agreement for certain targets for the protection of global biodiversity. Not only percentage of our terrestrial soils or areas, but also marine areas, but also certain goals that we will commonly achieve. And I hope that where we are now in this meeting, the Rio+20, we will be able to have as a great success as we had in Nagoya. You know the strategic goals. I will stick only to the strategic goal C, to improve the status of biodiversity by safeguarding ecosystem, species, and genetic diversity. that and all the other four targets are clearly met by and help to be met by keeping areas we want to protect from roadless. Economic benefits, again, beyond tourism, it's all these economic benefits from the ecosystem services this unique place to provide. And I would like to share a quote from a very important person from Greece. Nikos Kazantzakis, you know him from Zorbas, but he wrote many other amazing books. And he says that it's mine and mine alone the duty to save Earth. If Earth is not safe, it's my fault. So that's why we have this gathering of forces here to do this duty, to perform this duty, because we have a choice to open roads or not to open. And we need to discuss globally this choice. We need that we globally make roadless, keeping areas roadless, and an option for policymakers, and sometimes even an obligation. Thank you very much.